So I'm starting with the steroids, okay, which is the glucocorticoids. So steroids, if you talk about steroids, first of all, we should know the location, okay? So it's very, very clear that they are coming from the suprarenal gland, okay, which is just above the kidneys, right? So if you talk about the adrenal gland, okay, they are dividing into what? Cortex and? Yeah, they are dividing into cortex and medulla. And if you talk about cortex region, then we are having three regions, GFR, okay? So I'm not writing the regions over here, I'm just simply writing from the zona glomerulosa, we were having what? Mineralocorticoid. And which mineralocorticoid is there? Aldo? Yeah, that is aldosterone. Then from the zona fasciculata, what was there? Mineralocorticoid. Mineralocorticoid, for an example, glucocorticoids. Okay, and then you are having reticularis, that was sex hormones, right? So we are actually going to talk about aldosterone and glucocorticoids. Okay, from the medulla, very short, that from the medulla we are having what? Release of catecholamines. Which catecholamines do we know? We know about the epinephrine, we know about the norepinephrine, we know about the dopamine, right? But we will not talk about the catecholamines now, okay? We are going to talk about what? Mainly steroids, okay? Already we have talked about the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which was also called as non-opioids, right? Today we are going to talk about the steroids. Now, in short, if you talk about the aldosterone, what are the functions of aldosterone? Aldosterone function is what? Retention of what? Sodium ions and? Yeah, retention of water. As well as, it loses the potassium ions, as well as it loses the protons. Okay, so this is the function of what? Aldosterone. Okay, and in diuretic, I told you one of the drug was potassium sparing diuretic, that was spironolactone, which was opposite of aldosterone, which was called as aldosterone antagonist, and that was doing the opposite function of aldosterone. Okay, now if you talk about this one, that is what? Glucocorticoids. Okay, so usually let me talk about the classification of the steroids. As far as classification is concerned, we are having three classes. One is short acting, okay? One is intermediate acting, and the another one is longer acting, okay? So short acting, intermediate acting, and long acting. We are talking about classification. Okay, so if you talk about the shorter acting, most commonly we are having the cortisone, and then we are having hydrocortisone. Okay, cortisone and hydrocortisone. Then we are having intermediate acting. Intermediate acting is prednisolone and triamcinolone. Okay, so prednisone, prednisolone and triamcinolone. Okay, then at last we are having the long acting. In the long acting we are using what? Betamethasone, dexamethasone and paramethasone. Okay, so they are the long acting, okay, or you can say they are the longest acting because they are actually taking 1.5 days. They are actually remaining inside your body for 1.5 half day. Okay, so they are actually really longer acting steroids. Okay. On the other hand, if you talk about the aldosterone is actually what? Aldosterone is actually mineralocorticoid, right? It is actually what? This was the mineralocorticoid, right? Aldosterone. So one of the mineralocorticoid I told you, that was aldosterone. Okay. The next one which you can mention over here, that is fludrocortisone. This is also the mineralocorticoid over here. Okay. So fludrocortisone. Fine. So we are having short acting, we are having intermediate acting, and we are having the long acting steroids. Okay. So let me tell you the uses of the steroids first of all. Okay, let's say I'm taking the hydrocortisone over here. Okay, and let me talk about the uses, what purpose we can use these drugs. Okay, so if we are clear about the steroids, which are the endogenous steroid, which is the glucocorticoid, we are very well aware about the functions of the exogenous steroid as well, because at last they are actually same. Okay, so what are the functions? We are having several functions as far as steroids are concerned. If you want to compare between catecholamines, which is coming from the adrenal medulla, and the steroids which are coming from the adrenal cortex, adrenal cortex are much more important for our body as compared to adrenal medulla catecholamines. Okay, they are much more important, because look, if you talk about let's say we are talking about the hydrocortisone, they're actually breaking down your carbs. Okay, they're actually breaking down your fats. They are breaking down your proteins. Okay, they are actually increasing the metabolism of calcium ions. Okay, so they are doing these many things. Look, by the breaking down of the fats, have you heard about Cushing syndrome? Okay, this endocrinology disorder, Cushing syndrome. In the Cushing syndrome, what is happening? Central obesity. Okay, central obesity, because it is breaking down the fats from the periphery and depositing it in the center. So in the Cushing syndrome, what is actually happening? We are actually seeing the central obesity in the patient. Okay, so if you are giving too much steroids to any kind of patient, it can lead to actually what? Cushing syndrome. Okay. With the protein breakdown, it is actually related to muscles. So muscular atrophy can be seen in the patient. Okay, if you talk about the calcium metabolism, osteoporosis can be seen. Why osteoporosis? Calcium metabolism. So look, if there will be no calcium, bones will be much more weaker, and they are having pores inside the bones, which is also called like osteoporosis, and they are having much more chances of fractures. Okay, so fracture chance will be increased. So this much functions are there. Now if you talk about the other purposes, for an example, steroids. Now when can we use the steroid? Where is the basic need for the steroid? So you know, autoimmune situations, autoimmune conditions, for an example. So we are having several autoimmune conditions, so I'm writing it over here. Okay, again I'm talking about the uses of exogenous steroids. Okay, so let's say we are talking about the hydrocortisone. Okay, so first of all, one of the uses is autoimmune conditions. Okay, autoimmune conditions. Second one, you can use them in allergy. Okay, not even allergy, I will write it over here, asthma. Okay, you know, in the asthma we are using the adrenergic agonist, which is the beta 2 agonist, for example salbutamol. You can also use the anticholinergic, for example ipratropium bromide or tiotropium bromide, and we are mixing the steroids along with them, so that we can actually reduce the inflammation. After all, they are actually anti-inflammatory also. So we can give them in inflammation as well. Okay. So in the asthma, you can give autoimmune conditions, then it is having anti-inflammatory effect. So in the inflammation, you can give steroids as well. Okay. Then for suppressing the immune system, for example, for the transplantation purposes. So whenever the patient has to undergo some kind of transplantation or some kind of grafts, then you need to suppress the immunity and you need to give what? Immunosuppressants. So immunosuppressant, which immunosuppressant we are usually giving? We are giving the prednisolone in those situations. Okay. So actually it is also acting as immunosuppressant. Okay, so we are giving them in what? Transplants. Okay. Now, because we are giving them in inflammation, so it is an anti-inflammatory drug. Okay. Now, if it is anti-inflammatory drug, you are stopping the inflammation. Okay. In the patient, there is much more chances of infections. Because look, if you are suppressing the immune system, your immune system is not very well working in the body. If your immune system is not working in the body properly, then you are having more chances of getting infections. So these kind of patients who are on the steroids, okay, they, as a side effect, there can be what? Increased chances of infections in the body. Okay, so the body will be prone to more infections. Okay, so these are some of the functions of uses of the steroids. Okay. So what can be the uses? There can be the we can use them as an anti-inflammatory drug. We can use them in transplants for the immunosuppressants. We can use them in asthmatic situations. We can also use them as in the autoimmune conditions. Okay, so they are some of the uses as far as this is concerned. Okay, now if you talk about the release of the steroid from the adrenal cortex, then we know about the HPA axis, which is the hypothalamic hypophyseal axis or hypothalamic pituitary axis. So let me talk about HPA axis now. Okay. So if you talk about the HPA axis, look, let's say here is the hypothalamus. Okay, this is the hypothalamus over here. Okay, this is the hypophysis, which is also called as pituitary. Let's say this is the adenohypophysis, which is the anterior pituitary. And this is the posterior hypophysis. Let's say this is the neurohypophysis. So I am writing posterior pituitary. Okay, so this is the anterior pituitary. This is the posterior pituitary. Okay. So what will be happening, first of all, you know, from the hypothalamus, there will be the release of what? CRH, which is what? Corticotropin, releasing hormone. Then from the anterior pituitary, there will be the release of what? LHFSS, we don't need it for here. For the steroid purpose, I am asking. For ACTH. What is that? Adrenocorticotropic hormone, that is ACTH. Okay, there are several other hormones which are released from the anterior pituitary. What are the two hormones which was releasing from posterior pituitary? Oxytocin and? Oxytocin and vasopressin. Vasopressin is also called as? Antidiuretic hormone, ADH. Okay, from the anterior pituitary, you are having several hormones. Okay, but I am actually talking about ACTH. Okay, so cortisol releasing hormone is releasing from the hypothalamus, then hypothalamus will trigger the anterior pituitary to release what? ACTH. ACTH will now go to what is that? This is the suprarenal gland. Okay, and it will release what now? Glucocorticoids. Okay, now what will happen? Let's say some person is having the immunosuppression. Okay, let's say some person has to undergo through the process of transplantation or some kind of thing. Okay, let's say there was a case of kidney transplantation or renal transplant or liver transplant. In that case, you gave the patient prednisolone. Okay, so there is a rule of 2 weeks that you should not give glucocorticoids for more than 2 weeks. Okay, so in this case, you need to give prednisolone to the patient for more than 2 weeks, because if you will stop the prednisolone, then immune system will be activated and they will start to reject the graft in that case. So in that case, what I'm saying, the prednisolone usually they should be actually used in less than 2 weeks, because if there will be the uses of prednisolone for a longer period of time, let's say for 3 weeks or for a month, in that case there can be the suppression of, it can lead to what? It can lead to actually suppression of HPA axis. It can lead to suppression of HPA axis. HPA axis means hypothalamic pituitary axis. Okay, now look, if you are having normal, everything is normal, CRH is releasing normally, ACT is releasing normally, then you are having the release of glucocorticoids normally. Okay, usually what is happening, you are having the negative feedback inhibition also. So if you are having proper amount of glucocorticoid, it is having proper negative inhibition on ACTH, as well as it is having negative feedback inhibition on CRH. Okay, now if you are using prednisolone exogenously, which means you are giving the prednisolone to the patient in form of a drug, then look, you want to give the steroid. So steroid is coming from exogenous source. Okay, steroid is coming from the exogenous source. Now what will be happening, this adrenal gland will not produce glucocorticoid, because already there is what? Already you are giving steroid. If you are giving that for more than 2 weeks, okay, adrenal gland will start to feel that I should not release the glucocorticoid now, because already I am getting what? Steroid. Okay, and after 2 weeks or after 3 weeks, if you will stop the steroid now the adrenal gland is not ready to release glucocorticoid, because it will be thinking that already I am getting what? Steroids in proper amount. And now the adrenal gland will not produce the glucocorticoid, and the patient will be having adrenal insufficiency. Okay, so that's why prednisolone or glucocorticoids, you should be using them in less than 2 weeks, or they should be using in alternate manner. Alternate manner means alternate days. For an example, you're giving them on Monday, skipping that drug on Tuesday, and then Wednesday, and then Friday, in this manner. Okay, now in this case, discontinuation of the drug should not be appreciated. For an example, you are prescribing some prednisolone or you are prescribing some glucocorticoid, you should be actually telling the patient that do not stop this drug abruptly, because again it can lead to cause what? Suppression of this HPA axis, and the patient will be having adrenal insufficiency. So the patient should be needing the consultation from the physician before stopping the glucocorticoid therapy. Okay, so this drug should not be abruptly stopped. Okay, there are many drugs in the pharmacology, for example anti-epileptics also, they should not be stopped abruptly. Okay, so without consultation from the physicians, it should not be stopped. So but anyhow, you need to give prednisolone daily, and you need to give for more than 2 weeks. Then gradually monitor the patient, gradually you should actually decrease the dose of the glucocorticoids, so that adrenal gland will be having time to produce the glucocorticoids. Okay, so if the drug will be stopped abruptly, then again adrenal insufficiency will be seen in the patient. Okay, so please remember about that concept. Fine, so this insufficiency of adrenal gland is the most dangerous complication, you can say, or most dangerous adverse effect as far as glucocorticoids are concerned or steroids are concerned. Okay, fine. Then there is one more test which you can do for the steroids purpose, that is for checking the Cushing syndrome in the patient. For checking the Cushing syndrome in the patient, we are using the test named as dexamethasone suppression test. Dexamethasone suppression test. Okay. In this case, what you are using actually, you are taking, let's say, 1 milligram of dexamethasone. Okay, 1 milligram of dexamethasone. And then what you are doing, you are giving that in night time in the patient. You are giving that in night time. Shall I rub this portion? Now what will be happening? Look, in the Cushing syndrome, what is happening? As far as steroids are concerned, they will be elevated in the blood circulation, okay? And you are checking that whether this patient is having Cushing syndrome or not. You gave the drug in night time, okay? The patient will be sleeping now. After that, he will be waking up in the daytime, in the morning. And in the daytime now, you will be checking the... In the daytime now, you will be checking what? Check the steroid levels now. Check the steroid levels. If steroid levels are, if steroid levels are high in the blood circulation, then this patient is having Cushing syndrome. If the steroid level comes back to normal, then this was the physiological elevation of steroids in the blood circulation. Okay, let's say the patient, you check the patient and you are suspecting that high level of steroid levels are there in the blood circulation. So you want to know, look, physiologically also there can be high level of steroids, okay, due to any kind of stress. Okay, there can be high level of steroids in the blood circulation, but you want to check that if it is physiological or is it pathological, which means the patient may have the Cushing also. So you will be going for the dexamethasone test, 1 mg dexamethasone test. In the night time you will be giving to that patient, and in the daytime you will be checking the steroid levels. If they will be normal, then this was physiological elevation. Otherwise, if it is still higher, then this is the Cushing syndrome. Now this is the pathological situation. Okay, so steroids, dexamethasone is also a steroid, right? Dexamethasone, I told you, this is actually what? Longer acting. This is actually longer acting steroid. Okay, so this is one of the use for the dexamethasone. Fine. Further, dexamethasone and the betamethasone, they are the two drugs, these are longest acting, right? They are the longer acting steroids. We are also using them in the pregnant ladies. Okay, how we are using that? Let's talk about that also. So you can say this one is the antenatal use. Antenatal means before the birth. Antenatal use for the steroid. Okay, in this case you are using two drugs. These are the dexamethasone and you are using what? Betamethasone. Okay, usually physiologically what happens is whenever the pregnant lady, okay, she is giving birth to the child, what is the normal gestation period? Normal gestation period is 37 to 42 weeks. Okay, and on an average 40 weeks is the average gestation time, right? At this time the woman delivers, right? But you should remember that there can be some complications. Obstetrician saw some kind of complication in the mother, and the obstetrician wants that this baby should be giving, this mother should be giving birth now. But they will be seeing one thing, that whether the lungs of the baby are mature or not. And the lungs of the baby are mature at the age of 34 weeks of gestation. Okay, and if let's say the mother is having the gestation period, that is actually 31 weeks, let's say. So the obstetrician is having that doubt in the mind that if they will deliver the baby, still the lungs are not mature of the fetus. Okay, how the fetus will be surviving in the world. Okay, so they're having that doubt. So you need to actually extend that time period for the birth of the baby. So you can actually steal the time by giving what? Dexamethasone and betamethasone. Okay, so they are actually steroid and they will stimulate the production of surfactant in the lungs of the fetus. They will do what? They will stimulate the surfactant. And as there will be the production of surfactant in the lungs, it will actually helps to give the maturity to the lungs. Okay, so by doing this, you are stealing the time. Okay, so by doing this, physiologically, we know that at 34 weeks, the lungs will start to mature as far as fetus is concerned. Okay, but yes, if there is a complication, you can't wait for that much time. So you will start giving what? Steroids to the mother. Okay, which drug you are giving? Dexamethasone and betamethasone, they are the longest acting, right? One and a half day, they can stay in the blood circulation of the mother. And you can actually start making the surfactant in the lungs of the fetus. Okay, so one of the uses of the steroid is the surfactant. Understood, everybody? Okay, fine. So this is the antenatal use which you can think of, right? Other uses I told you already, they are the other uses as far as the steroids are concerned. Fine. Then we are having some kind of side effects or adverse effects as far as steroids are concerned, and the list is very, very long. So that's why steroids should be used very cautiously in the patients. Okay, so shall we move on to the side effects or adverse effects or contraindication of the steroids? Okay, one more thing, as far as steroids are concerned, what is the effect of the steroids on the blood circulation? Mainly about the WBCs. So look, steroids actually increases the level of neutrophils in the blood. Increase the level of neutrophils in the blood, and it can lead to what? Neutrophilia. Okay, at the same time, they can actually decrease the level of lymphocytes. So they can lead to what? Lymphopenia. Okay, so neutrophilia can be seen in the patient and lymphopenia can be seen in the patient. So lymphocyte will be reduced, neutrophils will be increased in the blood circulation. Now usually the question comes from the side effects or the adverse effects or the uses. So what can be the side effects as far as glucocorticoids are concerned? So let's talk about them. So side effects or adverse effects, or you can say contraindications of the glucocorticoids. So for the glucocorticoids complication, you can actually adverse effect, you can actually remember them with the help of glucocorticoids. Okay, so G4 over here is glaucoma. Okay, there can be open angle glaucoma in the patient. Okay, if you are using too much steroids, there can be the chance of increased risk of glaucoma in the patient. Okay, then there can be the limb muscles atrophy. Why there can be limb muscle atrophy? I told you already that there can be the protein breakdown. And if you are using that excessively, then excessively protein breakdown may happen in the patient and limb muscles atrophy can be seen. Then with the chronic use, there can be the ulcers. Which ulcers? Peptic ulcers. Okay, there can be the peptic ulcers in the patient. Then there can be in the eyes, there can be the complication which is cataract. Okay. Then O4 osteoporosis, I told you, you know, calcium metabolism will be increased. So the muscles will be, bones will be much weaker and having more chances of fractures. Further osteoporosis can be seen. Okay. Then C4 over here, you can say Cushing syndrome. In the Cushing syndrome, too much level of steroids are present inside the blood circulation. And if you're obviously you are giving the steroids on higher levels excessively, then Cushing syndrome might be the risk factor over there. Okay. O4, that is osteonecrosis. So breakdown of the bones part over there. R4, there can be renal failure in the patients on the chronic uses. T4, there can be tuberculosis. Okay, so tuberculosis can start to develop in the patient. I4, that is infections. So there are much more chances of the infections in the patients because, you know, inflammation, anti-inflammatory. So you are putting the risk over there to in those patients, okay, for the infections. C4, it can be congestive heart failure. Okay, so the heart can be weak. O4, if the edema, if the congestive heart failure is there, then it can lead to edema as well. For an example, pulmonary edema, left ventricle failure can lead to pulmonary edema further. Then I4, there can be impaired wound healing. So if there is some kind of wound present in the body, it will actually take much more time for the healing. Okay, so impaired wound healing. D4, there are much more chances of these patients are having much more chances of developing diabetes. Okay, and lastly, S4, I told you what? Suppression of which axis? HPA axis, or suppression of HPA axis, that is the hypothalamic pituitary axis. Fine. So these are the side effects and contraindications as far as glucocorticoids are concerned. Okay. Which one are very, very important? Osteoporosis, Cushing syndrome, they are very important for you to remember over here. Okay. Then very important is renal failure. Okay. Congestive heart failure and edema. Infection because of inflammation. Okay. And very, very important is suppression of HPA axis. Okay. So these are the adverse effects as far as steroids are concerned.